Okay guys, in front of me is the very famous Cork M1, and today I'm not going to talk about little games with 2 kilobyte of ROM, but we are talking about this massive synthesizer from 1988 that had a whopping 4 megabytes of ROM. Actually, it was astonishing amount of ROM back in 1988. You have to remember that the year before Cork came with this one, Roland had a massive hit with the D50, and the D50 only had 512 kilobytes of memory. But Cork didn't stop there. The next year, they came with an upgrade to the M1, and they called it the T-Series. It was a family of 3 different synthesizers, basically the same synth engine as the M1, but you had a 61 key, a 76 key, and an 88 key model with weighted piano keys. But what Cork also did with the T-Series is that they doubled the internal sample memory. So if you bought the M1 in 88, and it was quite a bit of money, you were thinking, okay, I'm not up to date anymore. So what Cork did is they came with an upgrade kit for this machine, so you could have the 8 megabytes of the new T-Series in your M1 as well. I'm going to install that today. It's a very geeky episode, because this will include a lot of soldering, a lot of hiccups will come to my table, and so if you're not into the geeky stuff, maybe you should come back for the next video. In the first part of my video, I'm just going to install the card in this machine. I didn't read any manual or instruction or anything. I just screwed it in, and I was very naive and thinking that it would work straight out of the box. That was very wrong. We will see why a little bit later. The thing is, and it's very logical now, is that when I'm putting hardware in this machine, how on earth would the machine know it has that extra hardware? So, very logically, I also need new software. I found out a couple of weeks ago, and then I found that software in the form of a small EEPROM kit. It came in a little tube like this, and with those EEPROMs, things should work out better. But that was not the whole story yet, because I also found the manual for the upgrade, and it was a little bit harder than I expected, because we also had to make modifications to the main board. Cork was selling this to end users, but it was not very easy. I received this little package, and we are going to open it and see if we can make the modification. Okay. And this is what should do the trick. This is the actual board, and as you can see, it has a couple of ROM chips added to it. This board is supposed to be in place of the PCM slot at the back. This is the card that came with the expansion kit for the M1, and it's very rare, because these sounds were from the T-Series, but with the T-Series you got it on a floppy disk, not on a card. So not a lot of people do have these cards. That's the stuff from the package. I'm going to turn this upside down, put something underneath. We have a lot of screws to remove. And what I always do is, there's a stick on the M1, and we don't want to break that. So I'm putting it upside down a little bit over the edge of the table. That way the stick won't damage. This. Okay, let's unscrew all these screws. They are just plain Phillips screws, it's very easy, but they are quite a bit. So I'm going to put this in fast forward. You slightly slide it forward, and you can pick the board off. Okay, here we have the main PCB. And the board we have to replace is under this one. I think I have to remove these as well. These are longer. It's for the a vertical card slot for the patch cards. And yeah, now it's getting out of the way. Let's see if we can detach it. Okay, I make a disconnect too. Carefully over to this side. Okay, underneath we have this little board, and this is the board with the PCM card connector. The connector is over here. It says KLM 1264, and this board should be replaced with the new board. Let's see if we can get that in. Need to remove more screws. There are two on the back holding the card slot in place. Okay, now it's loose. This is the other side. As you can see, here is the plastic slot that holds the card. The problem with this thing is that there are small brass strips inside the plastic, and they corrode or they bend outwards, but you cannot get to them, so it's very hard to change anything if it malfunctions. And this is one of the most troublesome parts of the Cork M1. If you just want to use the regular sounds, it's no problem, but for using the expansion cards, it's really giving a lot of headaches. Let's see if the new board fits in place. Okay, there's two connectors. Try to get them off. Okay, here we have them side by side. As you can see, the basic layout is similar, but this one has an added portion with the ROM chips. What I'm going to do now is I think the cables are supposed to be on this one, so I have to remove them on the other side. Okay, how to get this connector off? Here you see a ribbon cable connector, and there's a small slit here, and you can remove this with a screwdriver like this. And now you can retract the cable. I'm going to use the cable that's already in there, because I think the one that came with the board is in worse condition. The smaller cable, this one, you need to get off at the other side. Okay, now here I'm going to remove the ribbon cable as well. Okay, there it goes. It's a bit dusty. When I see dust, I fight it with a toothbrush. Okay. If you look at the layout, the connector is kind of turned around, so I'm going to help it a bit into place. It's a little tight, but I don't think that's much of a problem. Okay, let's put the screws back. Okay, it goes. I don't know whether it should be underneath, or maybe it's a little bit neater. All right,
we are going to move the main board back. Before we do so, we reattach the small power cable for the PCM board. Okay, that one is in place. If you put the main board back, make sure that the card holder aligns with the and I had to make sure that the big flat cable is nice in position. What I'm going to do now is I will put a couple of screws back and then I'm going to make a test drive, and otherwise I have a problem. Okay, this one plugs back here and this one plugs back here. Okay, check, this is back, this is back. So all cables are back in position. I'm going to turn this upside down at the mains and see if it works. I started with this a couple of weeks ago and I was installing the board and then nothing happened. So it was very naive to think that a hardware upgrade would do the trick. We also need to take care of new software, because how should the machine know that it has additional samples? So I found this one on eBay. It's a 2 EEPROM set, and this one is supposed to have the right software to make this M1 think that it's an expanded M1. Okay, there's another huge problem. My M1 doesn't have socketed EEPROMs, so that means I have to desolder them, and that's not funny. Okay, let's try if I can do that. Soldering iron is hot. Sucking device. Let's start. There it is. This one is labeled cork. Okay, on to the next. Wish me luck. Let's check it again. Wiggle the feet and then I can pop it out. I check if I can move the feet in the holes one by one. And if that's possible, the desoldering went okay. But there are some that are still stuck, so I have to remove some more solder. Okay, second ROM chip. I hope I can get some feed for this thing. Okay, I have an instruction here on my tablet, and I'm going to mark the places where I have to cut traces on the PCB, and I'm going to add two wires, and I have to cut those. I have to add something here. It's on this one, and it's connected to the ground, I have to cut that. So it's there. It's connected to this spot over here. So I have to make a wire there. Okay, let's do that.
Scary. Feel like a surgeon now. Traces are pretty tough. Good thick quality.
Okay, there's one way to find out. Check the resistance. I'm not sure if you can get infinity yet to resistance, because there's always some capacitors around that connect some internals. So I think 80 kilo ohm is more than enough. Now let's add the wires. Cut two wires, same color as on the example. So you can solder them to the right spot. Okay, that looks okay. I'm gonna check the resistance to the pins next to each other. There's no short. Okay, that's just in place. We've cut those. There's one more to add. We've cut this one here. Made another one, purple wire. Let's connect that one. Looks okay. Again, check the resistance to the neighboring spots. It's high. It's also high. It's also high. It's also high. I believe this part of the modification has gone okay, so I'm going to check what to do on the next board. Okay, this is the new board with the extra ROM chips, and here is an empty socket. And because this is the board that I'm replacing, I've got this cable extra. And what I'm going to do is I'm going to use this cable for this connector, and now I have to solder the wires on a chip directly on the main board. Okay, there's another puzzle. Over here, we have to solder this piece to that chip, but it says feed 3 has to go to pin 2 and 5 to pin 1, but there's no indication of pin 1 or 2 on the connector nor on the board. So I think we have to make a guess. On closer inspection, there is a small number 2 on the white connector, so there's a small number 2 on the orange wire, and that one has to go to number 3. I'm going to add a bit solder to this chip. And a bit over there. So. This is where the orange one goes. I'm not happy with that. Feels solid.
Looks okay.
Okay, so now everything is wired according to instruction. The only thing that I have to do is find sockets for the EEPROMs. So I'm going to the shop now and see if I can get some proper feed for that. An hour bicycling through the city to the other side. But I still have a shop with all electronic stuff. I didn't knew that. It kind of reminds me of the 80s. But so I found what I need. Two EEPROM sockets at €1.20 grand total. Let's put them in. Checking the orientation. All the pins are true. Let's solder again. So everything is in place. The wires, we did the cuts. We added the sockets for the EEPROMs. So now we have to see what happens if we put it back together. All right, this is the package with the EEPROMs. They are nicely labeled where they should go. Okay, this is number 32.
A bit more space. Goes much better.
Chips are in place.
Let's check 32, 32, 23, 23. The notch
at the right position. It's time to put everything back together. The first thing to position is this board. And before we do that, put this one a little bit back. We added new cable, so that one has to be connected to this board. All right, that's okay. And now this has to be in here. And this one has to go like that. I'll put it here. I can't see much right now. Okay, this one is in place. I'm not going to put all screws back because we need to test first if everything worked out. The PCM card slot is in place. Okay, the ROM board is in place. Now I have to rewire all the connectors. This one came from this place. This one is from the power supply. It goes here. what else did I pull off? Anything loose at the moment?
I don't think so.
Oh yeah, this one. Oops, just in time. All right. Now everything is back in place. We align the board to the program card connector. The long ones are for this place. Okay, let's boot this machine and see if everything is okay and the upgrade worked out fine. If you want to reinstall the sounds of the M1, there's two ways of doing so. You can do it over MIDI. I will show it in another video. And you can do it by using the cards that Korg gave with the M1. And this is the third card, and this card came with my upgrade kit. And it's the MPC-0EX. This card contains 100 patches from the T-Series and the 100 combinations from the T-Series. So we are going to install these to see if the upgrade worked. Putting the card in the program slot. To reset the machine, you have to hold Int and card and then boot the M1. Okay, I just saw the new ROM version shortly. It's ROM version 29, and that's the latest version for the M1, and it's the one for the updated version. And now let's see if we can load the presets. To do so, I put it on global. I'm going to almost the last page. And it says load from card. And I want to load the programs and the combis. That's the default setting. And I press load. And are you sure? Yes, I'm sure. Okay, it's completed now. And when I put it on program now, program 00 has changed to One World. Let's check if it is okay, because One World uses a sample that is not in the original M1. So if it sounds weird, it didn't work. Excellent. I think I succeeded. This machine sounds okay. It can load the card. There's one thing to check. Does it also load a card in the back? Because that is something that changed as well. Here is it. The PCM slot was replaced with a new PCM slot. And I didn't know yet if the PCM slot that came with the upgrade is also working, because they tend to be faulty. To check if the card slots work well, I have this card set. It's the orchestra set. It's one of the nicer sets that you could get as an expansion. This one has another 512 kilobyte of samples, the same as a whole D50 on a single card. And this one has the sounds that you can make with it, including a very, very nice demo song. Put this in, this one on the back, and I'm going to put it on card. And to check if it works, I choose edit program, and I'm going to the second page, and it's a little bit flaky, I think. And now it works. These card slots are very, very sensitive to dust, or I don't know what. This one is actually working always. There's no problem with this one, but the PCM slot, it's always a little bit awkward. But now it works. I can see the samples, C19. So from C00 to C19. This one has 20 samples, and they are all there. So I can play the card sounds as well. So I can conclude that everything works fine. It sounds okay. The cards read well. I have the new version of ROM in the window. So I'm very happy that I succeeded. So now my M1 is a M1EX. I don't have the nice sticker that came with the package, so you can only see it by using it. But I think it's a worthwhile upgrade, because with 4 megabytes, I basically have the same as 8 of these extension sets added to this machine. So this was a very, very long video. It was very geeky. I doubt there will be a lot of viewers on this one, because there's not many of those expansion cards out there. And I wonder who is going to do this crazy job just like I did. But if you happen to find one of those expansion cards, give it a try, because it will make your machine much more capable, and it's a waste to throw the cards in a dumpster. Okay, thank you for watching. This one was very geeky. I plan to do more on the M1. For example, I happen to have almost all the expansion cards, and I'm going to show them in another couple of videos. There's not much information on YouTube on that. So there will be more M1 stuff in the future. And if you look closely, there's more Synth stuff here. And this one is going to be in a video as well. Thanks for watching, and hope to see you soon. Why is it always that the sun is shining on Thursdays? Damn it! It's the day I want to make movies.